Moses was then told to continue climbing the mountain with Joshua. This is where God gives him the tablets with the law and the Ten Commandments. The sight of the glory of the Lord was like a consuming fire on the top of the mountain. Could the blackened peak of Mount Sinai be evidence for God's holy presence?
Mount Sinai was all in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire, and its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked violently. The top of these mountains are dark, showing signs of burnt marks. The outer parts of the rocks are black, but on the inside, they are brownish in color. And you can see here, there's been some rocks that have been chipped away, and you can see that on the outside they're black and on the inside they are brown. This seems to be more evidence that this mountain and the surrounding mountains close by were covered with fire and smoke. Scripture says the mountain was on fire for 6 days and appeared as if it was going to be consumed. Another piece of strong evidence is that at the base of this mountain an altar has been discovered. This would match what Scripture states in Exodus 24, 4 and 5, and built an altar at the foot of the mountain with 12 memorial stones for the 12 tribes of Israel.
Moses rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. A structure can still be found today at the base of Mount Sinai. Its particularity is that it is made out of uncut stones as God commanded. If you make an altar of stone for me, you shall not build it out of cut stones. This is where the animals would be kept in line, ready to be sacrificed. The remains of the 12 pillars can still be seen almost 3,000 years later at the foot of Mount Sinai. And the people thirsted there for water, and they complained against Moses and said, "Why is it you have brought us out of Egypt? To kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I will stand there before you on the rock in Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it that the people may drink." The rock stands 50 feet tall and can easily be seen from a great distance.
Oh, it's incredible.
It is incredible. It is absolutely massive.
We can imagine millions of gallons of water flowing out into the nearby camp. The rock itself shows signs of water erosion.
Shows water grooves in it where massive amounts of water ran down from it. And you can see this rock and the water channels and grooves that were made when the water gushed out from it. Now God confirms this in Isaiah 28:21. It says, "They did not thirst when he led them through the deserts. He made the water flow out of the rock for them. He split the rock and the water gushed out." And this is exactly what we see here at this large, massive rock at Rephidim.
And they came to Elim, where there were 12 wells of water and 70 palm trees. And they camped there by the waters. of wells can still be spotted along the oasis. Some are even used by the locals to this day. There are numerous date palm trees in Elim, which makes it the perfect spot for the children of Israel to find rest. Between Mount Sinai and the altar, we notice a cave looking down the valley. The prophet Elijah traveled for 40 days and 40 nights. He kept going until he arrived at the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night.
Thing about this is the only cave on this mountain, and this is the place.
The manna was like coriander seed and looked like gum resin. The people would gather it and grind it between two millstones or beat it in the mortar.
So over here we can see a big rock with a huge dent in it. And this was used to grind manna. So with a pestle and a mortar, this would be the mortar.
Many of these mortars can be found around Mount Sinai.
This is where they poured the wing of the cherubim of the Ark of the Covenant right here. Wow. That's that stone form. That is a form to make a hammered work, or take this plate of gold while it was not cold yet, was not fully formed, while it was cooling, and they would place it right over this form, and they start hammering on it, beating on it gently, precisely, until it turned into the wing of the cherub of the Ark of the Covenant. No sane person can say that this metalworks area is not the metalworks area that they used to build not only the tabernacle, but the Ark of the Covenant and everything that went into the tabernacle of Moses, the sanctuary that he called Moses to build. I tried to get as good a picture as I could. When you get really close to it, this part right here tapers at an angle, sort of like a semicircular angle, down to the ground, and then this part is straight flat across. This is the weathered part, obviously, what the rain has beaten on and the wind and the sun. So the detail is close to gone, but when you're in person in front of it, you can see the lines of the feathers. That's what these are, the feather lines. And they curve around, and they match right there on top. They all line up with each of those lines, and maybe you can see it a little bit. If you're there, you can see it for sure. This is a wing. But when you go through all the calculations based on Exodus 25 verse 9, where it says the length of the ark is 2.5 cubits, 20.62 inches per cubit, which means 51 inches, and change, cut that in half, you've got 25. A little bit of overlay on each side so the wings overlap and something for the base behind the mercy seat. And going through all that, you come up with just over 36 inches for the length of that wing. 3 feet, give or take. And again, thankfully for Bob, he put his foot down right beside it. And when you take that foot-long boot and you put it 3 places right beside each other, you have 36 inches, 3 feet on the money.
Amen. Well, I climb down the mountain and get back to my life. I won't settle for ordinary things. I'm gonna follow you.